Good morning, good evening, sorry. Thank you guys for being here. Welcome to tonight's candidates forum. We are happy to have the four candidates for the St. Johnsbury House of Representatives race with us this evening. And my name is Dana Gray. I'm the editor of the Caledonian Record. And on behalf of the Caledonian Record and the League of Women Voters, I want to thank you all for being here this evening, for taking this time out of your busy schedules to educate yourselves about the four candidates that you'll be voting on a week from today. So thank you for doing your part to educate yourselves and to having a better informed vote when you go to the polls. I also want to thank the Athenaeum for this very comfortable space that we have to do this. Thank you to Bob Jolly and his staff for making it available to us. And I also want to thank KATV for being here. They're going to be filming and they will be showing this. I don't know what the schedule is, but we'll have a story in the newspaper tomorrow that will tell you when it will be on the television. So stay tuned for that. Before I introduce Karen Bufka from the League of Women Voters, who did a tremendous amount of work to bring this together, and I'm very grateful too, I just want to also say thank you to the four candidates for being here, for taking their time at the 11th hour of their candidacies to be with us this evening and share where they stand on the issues and what they hope to do for us when they get from Australia. Win or lose next week, guys, we do appreciate your willingness to serve. Karen?
Thank you, Dan, and thank you. It's so great to see all of you here prepared to soak up some good information so you can be an informed voter. Just in case you don't know about the League, but actually, let me ask, how many of you do know about the League of Women Voters? Hey, this is awesome, some old friends. But new friends, too, might need to know who we are and why we're involved in doing this. The League of Women Voters is a national, nonpartisan volunteer organization open to people of all genders, which encourages the active and informed participation of citizens in government, works to increase understanding of major public policy issues, and influences public policy through education and advocacy. The League was founded in 1920 when the women of the suffrage movement realized that they would indeed receive the right to vote finally, but that those millions of women who were going to be able to vote would not know how to vote from beginning to end. They would not know how to do any of it. So that's when the League was formed, and the purpose of the League being formed was to help those millions of new voters navigate the process from registration to gathering information, sorting through it, and all the way to passing a ballot at the polls on the day of the election, which, as you guys know, is quite a journey from beginning to end. We've been doing it ever since, so almost 100 years. Locally, we've been recently doing a lot of information and registration tables. If we have one at the college today, which is a great thing to see college kids engaging, getting registered right there on their phone. We've been tabling at the wet market and where else? Just in doing events like this, just to help people know that their voice is important to our democracy. So we're very lucky to have our moderator, Regina, Hazel, with us tonight. She is a member of the League of Women Voters of Vermont. Prior to Vermont, she was a member of the Connecticut League of Women Voters, where she moderated candidate debates and promoted voter education. Regina is currently in her eighth year serving as town moderator in Raleigh, Vermont. Regina.
If anyone has any questions, we need to get them written out on those cards. So if you have a question, raise your hand. And gentlemen in the back will quickly collect it so that we don't miss out on it while we are debating. Anyway, thank you for coming. We're here to listen and learn, so let's get started with introductions. From left to right, your left to right, is Brendan Hughes, Republican. Scott Beck, Republican incumbent, seeking his third term.
Better get over here.
The next one candidate is Democrat Scott Campbell and Jane Pompeo, Democrat. There are your four candidates for two positions. You will see these four names on the ballot next week for the two seats representing St. Jay. Now, the order you see them in was literally drawn out of a hat a few minutes ago, and this is the order in which they will give their two-minute opening remarks. We will do the reverse order for closing remarks of 1 minute and start with Jane and work our way this way, trying to be as fair as possible. We will also rotate questions. We have prepared questions and the ones from the audience, which I'm sure you're interested in hearing the responses. And we will rotate the questions so that everyone has an opportunity to be the first one to answer a question. You'll have 2 minutes each for each question. Our timer tonight is lead member Heather Alger. Hi, Heather. The candidates will see a 1 minute. You'll then see 30 seconds. You will then see stop. And we're going to stay strictly with the time limit. So if you hit stop, you can finish your sentence. Okay. Also, from the audience, please turn off cell phones if you haven't already. And refrain from clapping. It's nice, but it takes time, and it can be a distraction. So we're going to not clap. You can clap at the end. Okay, are there any questions before we start on procedure? Okay. Well, you are applying for a job. One has held the job, and three others are applying for one of the two seats. The league is all about education. So therefore, what's your job description? I have it here. Don't worry. The Vermont House of Representatives and the Vermont State Senate form the legislative branch of the Vermont state government. And their work includes creating and processing bills that, if passed, become state law, setting levels for state spending, raising or lowering taxes, and voting to uphold or override gubernatorial vetoes. Most of the work of a state representative occurs in the standing committee to which they are assigned. Committees receive testimony from the public regarding proposed legislation, evaluate the bill, and make recommendations about it. Representatives, therefore, do a lot of listening, reading, contemplating, discussing, and even debating, all on behalf of the citizens of their home communities and the greater community of Vermont. So with that in mind, we will begin with your two-minute opening statements.
Thank you, Regina.
You're welcome.
I also want to take this opportunity to thank the League of Women Voters, as well as the Athenaeum and the Caledonian Record for having this great venue for tonight, so you can hear the candidates and where they stand and make a more educated decision once we get there Tuesday next week. Heather, I hope you're not too angry at me by the end of the night for being the moderator, or for being the timekeeper. I see around that I've met a lot of you already between walking door to door, different events around town, or even select board meetings and other venues like that. But for those of you who don't know me, my name is Brennan Hughes. I was born and raised here. I went to St. Johnsbury Academy. I graduated in 2012. Since then, went to Stone Hill College, graduated with an undergrad degree in biology, planning to be a dentist. I actually worked here at the St. Johnsbury Dental Office with Kathy Soloway for 5 years as a dental assistant. After graduation, I decided to apply to dental school as well as a master's program at the University of Notre Dame and chose that instead. So it was centered around entrepreneurship, mostly in startups, so taking STEM background students and applying the business side of technical companies to be able to run it as a business. After graduating that, it was just great that the opportunity opened at the academy that I was able to start working at the admissions office there. And then since then, I've also started at St. John's Distillery, which is hopefully going to move here in the center of town later next year. We've hired 6 full-time and part-time employees since starting, and sales are up 86%. So really excited about that. I mean, it's really dedicated to the town, but the reason why I kind of wanted to run is I'm very concerned about the affordability here in Vermont. As somebody who moved back here as a young individual, I plan on living and dying here in this state, and I really want to help affordability in that sense that we can really strengthen our economy and allow our population to grow and keep people here in the town, as well as the state. That's very important, and that's kind of why I decided to run.
Good timing.
Yeah.
Scott.
My name is Scott Beck. I'm running for re-election to the Vermont House of Representatives. I'd also like to thank the League. I'd also like to thank everybody that's here, everybody in our society was engaged as a citizenry here this year tonight. We would be a far stronger country. So I applaud you all for coming this evening. If you don't know much about me, I was born in St. Johnsbury, spent the first 30 years of my life back and forth between military assignments and being here and then coming back in 1999. I've lived in town ever since. I have six children. They all attended the St. Johnsbury School, grades P through K up through grades 8. They had a wonderful experience there, and they all have either graduated from the academy or they are in attendance at the academy. My wife and I, we own a family business, a bookstore in town, and I spend quite a bit of my time volunteering around. I'm the founder of the owner of the World Maple Festival. I also do the Battle of Bennington barbecue community lunch. I volunteered for almost 20 years for St. Johnsbury Baseball. I think I've been elevated to the job of the groundskeeper now. I'm also the lead voice and the lead force behind bringing a sportsplex to this community so that our kids and our families and our senior citizens can have suitable recreational opportunities. My first two terms in the House, I was on the Education Committee, and we passed some significant legislation. I think we will have some more time to talk about that as the evening goes on. Trusted member of both parties, I'm always in the room when big education decisions are being made, especially finance. I'm a fiscal conservative. I was very disappointed in my first 2 years in the House where the legislature and Governor Shulman decided to spend more than the revenue growth. I'm glad that has changed the last couple years, so we can talk more about that later this evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Scott.
Hello, I'm Scott Campbell. Thank you, Regina, Dan, Sharon, Bob Jolly, all of you here. It's great to see you all. I moved here in 2005 with my family, married me, stuck in town, and my three children. We lived for 15 years over here in Burlington and in West Fulton. And we really grown to love this town, and we've been glad to stay here forever. My background is in building construction and building design and building science. And building science is sort of another word for making buildings work better. Maybe more healthier, more comfortable, safer, and also use less energy. It's a business focused on long-term investments and cost-effective investments. And that is, what work can we do now whose costs will be more than saved by reduced energy costs in the future? And that's the perspective I want to bring to tonight's discussion and to the State House in general. So I feel we have challenges in St. Johnsbury and rural Vermont that will get, that have gotten severe and will get much more severe if we don't address them successfully. We'll probably talk a lot about them. I see I only have a minute left, but demographics is certainly one of the major crises that I think we're facing. Another challenge is the changing global economy, and another challenge that many of us don't like to talk about is we ignore it or pass over the things in the future is climate change. But I think it's really an existential crisis facing civilization, and it's going to have its impacts here in Vermont and even St. Johnsbury. So these challenges, I think, are not theoretical, they're real and the reality now. And so my focus is on how do we address those challenges and build a sustainable economy for the long term.
year, and worked in the mental health field for the last 18 years. And I'm running for state representative to bring a voice of common sense and a different perspective to Montpelier. As a mother, a grandmother, and a mental health professional, I'm part of the 40% of the population that has worked for 3 jobs to make ends meet for their experience. I bring that perspective to Montpelier, one that may be shared with many today. The legislature should reflect the people it serves and decision makers who are genuinely and enthusiastically fight for greater opportunity and better lives. In my time at canvassing over the past months, I've enjoyed talking and listening to many individuals. And what I've learned is that people do care about affordable child care, affordable health care, accessible and quality, and a livable wage and quality education. And they do care about a clean environment and a solution to the opioid crisis. And these are the issues that I support. And that's the vote.
Great. Thank you all very much. Our first question from the audience, we have several on healthcare. Okay, so we're going to start with you with the first question. And it is, what are the two most important issues you feel need to be addressed to decrease the rise in healthcare costs and increase access to healthcare?
Thank you. So, like I said in my opening statement, I'm working for the St. Johnsbury dental office. What I saw there, especially within Vermont, there's a huge problem with access to specialists here in the state, especially specialists who will take Medicare or Medicaid, which is very important to our population here in Vermont. I know the dental office did a great job of requiring more specialized people to the state, and that was a great need that was sustained here in this area. So that's one of them that I think is a main concern, and that's a lot of acquiring those people who have graduated. And there's a lot of federal as well as state funding for loan repays and everything like that. So making sure that that's educated within the field to allow them as an avenue to come back here and say that their 2 years of their loans will be repaid. I think that's very important. Also, really opening up the market to have free capitalism within that field of healthcare. One of the things that I think is very important, is especially on the commercials of talking about drugs and everything like that, that it is notified how much those drugs cost to make it more an educated decision once you go to your doctor and talk about how to pay back and whether your healthcare will be able to pay that. That's one other way, and also just being able to shop around and having the open market of being able to decide what the best option for you is in order to get the healthcare you need. And obviously, it's very important for everybody to have that opportunity to get the healthcare that they need, no matter what their background's in. So I think it's very important to myself.
Thank you. I think that this is, we could talk for hours about this, obviously. I think Vermont's made a shift that we're trying, and the early results, I think, are promising in the all-payer system, whereby medical professionals are being paid to keep people healthy instead of just fee-for-service, fee-for-test, whatever. I think that's important. I think we should continue that. We may have an opportunity here in the next year or two as the teacher health care moves into one plan. We have an opportunity to move them over to that system, make it even bigger, and there's a lot of evidence to indicate that bigger would be better. And of course, I say bigger in the context of Vermont, but I think bigger is better when you're talking about all payer. I think that Brendan touched on it. I think that we need a more competitive system. Our insurers right now, we basically have two. And I think breaking down the barriers between states would be a good thing. I also think that we need to be smart about preserving the protection of pre-existing conditions. I know it does increase the cost, but I think we have a responsibility to do that.
Thank you. The next guy.
Well, first, my view of healthcare proceeds from the view that healthcare is a right and not a privilege. And we need to move to a system that covers They're also higher costs due to cost shifting from people who don't have health insurance to and can't pay to those who do have insurance and can't pay. So that results in the exorbitant bills that you see, even if you don't have to pay them, even if your insurance company's paying them. And for people who don't have insurance or who run out of insurance, it results in ruinous financial implications, medical bills for them. It's a leading cause of bankruptcy in this country. And I just think this is an unsustainable system. Ultimately, universal health care will lower costs and rationalize care. And I think we need to begin the transition. And the smartest idea that I've heard so far is moving to, I hear what Medicare for All is the right idea, but making a transition or a stepping stone to that is making Medicare available as an option that people can buy, a public option. But I really think that we've got to start charting a course to transition to everybody being covered.
Thank you, Jane.
I agree with Scott, most of me, that health insurance is a right and not a privilege. And we shouldn't have to choose between whether we get good health care or buy groceries for our family or gas for our car or go to the doctor. You know, we should be able to do those things. And I do believe that we should be able to work in a holistic and humanistic approach to preventive health care, to work to have a healthier society. Our environment cleaner for our society and to keep healthy children in the schools. And I think that Medicare for All is a good system. I think Medicare works okay for me right now, but I have a supplement insurance program that I pay that costs a lot of money, but I do it right now. And there are advantage programs that can be looked into, so I think that could be looked into, and you could try to find more ways to help that.
Thank you. The next question from the audience is to do with education. Governor Scott has spoken of the need to reduce spending on education, specifically pre-K through 12. What is your position specifically on the proposed reduction? There's a second part, and it's how do you address the increased demands that have been placed on our public schools in the area of social services? This question goes to Mr. Beck.
Okay. Thank you. Right now, in the state of Vermont, our school districts decide how much money is spent. And I think that it would be wise if we continued that. I don't think it's in anybody's best interest to have legislators or bureaucrats in Montpelier deciding how much we spend on children's education. With that being said, the funding formula right now has a fatal flaw. That flaw has been there since Act 68 was passed. And right now, our school districts, the rates that they receive for the level of spending that they choose to take part in is far too loose. And what happens is that our high-spending districts are not paying an appropriate rate for their spending decision. They are receiving a discount. And our lowest-spending districts, and St. Johnsbury has the lowest education tax rate of any district in the state of Vermont, we pay a premium on our rate to help the higher-spending districts receive a discount. We can very easily reconnect those two much more closely. I have proposed that legislation. It made it through the House this year. Bipartisan bill was supported by the Speaker, Chair of Ways and Means, Chair of Education. Unfortunately, there are some in the Senate that look at equality as a problem only when it's not in their favor. And so we were not able to get it through the Senate. But like most bills, it takes a session or two to get it through its totality. And I think by reconnecting they need to have the basic building blocks of knowledge and in order to continue a lifelong learning. And kids are coming into school. The second part of the question was about the other things that the school is spending money on. The social services, the dealing with kids who are coming from homes with and coming to school with adverse childhood experiences, ACEs as it's called, has become a much more severe issue, much more severe spending issue since the last few years, the last 10 or 15 years. And this is not something that you can't compare how much we're spending on schools now to how much we were spending 15 years ago because of that issue. So I just think there's a lot of focus on per pupil spending as the metric for deciding where school funding is. And when the population is going down and you have these costs going up, then obviously the per pupil spending is going up. So I'd rather focus on the outcomes and how do we fund the schools to get to those outcomes. Thank you.
I think that it's a mistake if we cut funding to preschool, pre-K, and on up. I think most of the funding, if it goes to early childhood education, it has been shown that children do better and they people are kept out of jail with better education. And I don't think we should cut those funds. I think that we should look at the situations in the schools and try to figure out where the money should be spent better, and if there are increased demands in social services, where are they lacking and why do we need these extra social services? Is it because of the families and do they need more attention or and just pay more attention to looking at cost savings and based on just more than just assumptions of where they need to be. But I do think that investing in early childhood education just invests in our future and gives us better citizens, keeps people out of jail, kids get better education, and they get to go on to further education and learn skills. And I hope that wouldn't happen. I hope we can fund those schools.
Thank you. The next question is on climate change.
Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me.
No problem. So I don't think there's any argument for anybody who's up here about how important funding education is throughout our population here. However, I do like what Scott Campbell said about measuring the outcomes, about measuring how they're coming out, what their effect is to the population and like that. But a lot of it goes down to keeping them here in the state, and that goes back to affordability. So that's why I really like what Scott Beck said about controlling it within the districts rather than a bureaucracy within the state to mandate how it's paid out, because especially having the fact that we're paying a premium within our education budget in this side of the state compared to other states who are wildly spending uncontrollably, I do think it's very important to control that spending so that the next time it comes up, there's a little bit more of a restraint. But it's very important to have that funding intact. We're one of the top states within the United States that for education, and I see it constantly throughout the academy, people are moving up here because of our education system. They also like the town voucher system that they're able to go to the academy and be a part of this community and have a great education like that in diversity and everything that the academy offers. But it also goes down to our lower elementary and middle school system as well. So there's no arguments about how important the actual funding is for the education. We just need to control it a little bit better. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry about that. Okay, the next question goes to Mr. Campbell. It's on the economy and workforce. What will you do differently, specifically, to create conditions for a thriving economy and to attract and retain qualified workforce?
Thank you. Well, I think what we need to focus on is opportunity, infrastructure, and amenities. We just need to support businesses and individuals who are willing to take the risks and to invest. And we need to
half of those businesses an educated and skilled workforce. The workforce needs infrastructure in order to be attracted to it. We need housing. I went to a small business forum a few weeks ago, and the business owners talked about a few things. There were a few items that many of them talked about. One of them was internet, and the internet is high-speed internet everywhere. And we've been trying to do that for a number of years, but we really need to get it done. Childcare is another big issue for especially young families. Obviously, people are focused on housing, quality of schools. We have great schools in this town, and that's a great thing. We have a lot of assets we can build on. We also need amenities to draw the millennials and young families to move here. They're interested in arts and culture. They're interested in recreation, restaurants. And we have, again, a lot of things to build on. We have our arts, we have the museum, we have this beautiful facility, we have a newspaper. So I think we need to leverage those assets to address the challenges that we're facing, including the aged population, senior housing and services would be an economic engine for our area. So if we had a place for all of us who are getting older to go to, then we would stay here, maybe our children would come here to take care of us as we reach our age. And like the same token, young families who have older parents, if there was a place for them to go, these are the kinds of things that will help build a thriving economy.
Thank you.
I don't think I can add much more. You did say a little bit of wage. Did you say equal pay for everybody? For women and women? And I was thinking of maybe some business, entrepreneur business training for women would encourage people. I mean, here are just a lot of women bringing their families up by themselves, and so we need to encourage and support those families. And make sure that they're making enough money to stay here and be able to give their kids this wonderful education as I was, to be able to stay and thrive and grow. And that takes all the things that Scott said and that I agree with.
Thank you. Brenda.
Thank you for this question. It's kind of deep to my heart with owning a business here in town. But a lot of it goes down to creating career-based jobs. That's very important for Vermont in general, but acquiring more people for the workforce to relocate here, having those opportunities to thrive in a career, have ownership of that spot, drives a better workforce and everything like that. And in order to do that, we need to become an incubator for small businesses. Constantly throughout the past 5 years, we're rated the lowest among all the states in the union in business friendliness. Forbes last year rated us number three, with only Alaska and West Virginia behind us. We're 12% over the median cost of running a business. It's nuts how we need to be able to really thrive with our businesses here and really go out of our way to promote those businesses and allow them to flourish. And that is why it's very important to have those businesses to remain here in town, and especially on the east side of Vermont. We're competing with New Hampshire, which is ranked really high within their friendly
stock market to be in. I mean, you can move to New York and the electricity costs are almost half of what they are in Vermont. It's really, really onerous. And the taxes are high. And you add all of that, and you factor in most businesses which are operating with a very small profit margin, and they look at the playing field, and they think, I can have a higher likelihood of surviving in a different state with a different cost structure. And so I think we have to look at all that stuff, and we have to be competitive. We can't be 12% more expensive than other states, because if we are, businesses are, they're going to make different decisions than we want them to make, and that's going to, it's going to hurt our economy long term.
Okay. The next question goes to Jane. And keeping with economic development, what changes would you like to see in the next 10 years in terms of economic development in St. Johnsbury? And what do you think is our greatest potential in St. Jay? How best can we leverage that?
I don't know about 10 years from now. We do need to have businesses that thrive and can develop in the community, but I think that's a question for me.
It's a tough question for anyone, but is there some areas of economic development you support that would lead us in a direction of change in the next 10 years? If that helps. Okay, well, you might be able to add a few words to that the next go around.
Yeah.
So would you like to pass at this point?
Okay.
All right. So now, Brendan.
I do like how we've seen pretty much a turning point here in Vermont and in St. Johnsbury in particular, that when you look at Railroad Street, there's about 8 businesses that are doing renovations, starting up. There's a good turnover going on right now, but we need to continue with that momentum. And a lot of that goes back to helping with the permit processes, being able to have that knowledge of going through the businesses, and especially with regards to the state, getting some help in that regard of knowing the processes you need to go to, cutting costs, helping them to get to where they need to go, and making sure that it's knowledgeable about what kind of programs are out there for them to get funding. I feel like a lot of people who want to be entrepreneurs in this area don't know what kind of funding is out there, and especially state-funded areas that they can get tax credits, which is super important for businesses who are starting up. I know it's very important to us, at least at St. Johnsbury Distillery. So just in that way, if we can continue with that and really promote those kind of areas, I think in the next 10 years, we can see a big change and shift in not only what our town looks like, but just the demographics that are here, diversity, and people who are relocating here because they want to be a part of this community. I mean, you look around to the people who are here, and it's just an amazing place full of people who are spirited and prideful about being here. And I think a lot of people will go along with that and want to be a part of this community. But we just need to start and have that career base and our people here that they can actually relocate here, have a part of the St. Johnsbury Academy, get a great education, and get a decent job here in the town. And that goes back to just giving them that benefit of a little bit of help in the beginning to really start up and do something great.
Thank you for the question. I could go on for hours, but I had to hold myself to 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
Location is huge, and we need to embrace that. Our positioning on highways, state and federal, and our positioning equidistant between Montreal and Boston, and between Portland, Maine, and Toronto. That's enormous selling point for us. We're going through a major economic restructure in this town right now. We're not unusual, most of the world is. Brendan mentioned, I think it's 9 businesses, 8 or 9, that are coming into the Railroad Street area of St. Johnsbury. They're in the process of opening. Only one of those is retail. The others are like manufacturing, food, exercise. I mean, it's going to be a very different mix down there as the world economy changes as far as the retail and service sector. We need to embrace that. And we need to figure out how to be attractive to those types of businesses. And as members of this community, we need to frequent those businesses. Because if we don't, they won't stay around. And you won't help them to replace them. So that's really important. We need to use the existing tax incentives that the state of Vermont offers, not new ones, but the existing ones, TIF districts, tax credits for aesthetics, tax credits for life safety, tax credits for handicap access. These are all available to us, and we need to use them as much as we can. And we need to do everything we can to make it so that investors, private investors, can come into this community and invest and know that they're going to get something out of it. We need hundreds of millions of dollars of investment in this community. The state of Vermont can maybe only give us $1 or $2 million. We have to be attractive to private investors. The public sector is not going to be able to do this for us.
Heather Scott.
Scott Beck, I agree with everything you said. I think that what we're trying to do is economic development. The question is economic development over a 10-year period. It takes 10 years to see the results of investments and strategies that will grow our economy. I'm focused more on the investment side. What do we need to do to create infrastructure and amenities that will draw young people here and keep young people here? Because that's, you know, there's all kinds of another story that people told in that business roundtable that I went to a couple weeks ago. The business owners can't find qualified staff, so we need to bring those people here. So I'm thinking about investments as the key to creating the environment where young people want to move to and bring their families. I think of other examples of other towns that are thriving. St. Albans is a good example. St. Albans was really in tough shape until just a few years ago. And they invested a lot in their town using the TIF districts and using other mechanisms to create the foundation that private businesses can build on. Whitebird Junction is another example, and that's just happened in the last few years. Whitebird Junction is also on the coast, right next to New Hampshire, same as we are. So I think we can do it, and I know we can do it. We just have to focus on what investments we can make that will bring these folks here and provide an environment where businesses and individuals want to take the risk and make their own investments.
Thank you.
I guess I'd like to add that I think it's exciting, and I'm glad I heard what everybody had to say, and that it's great that we can have revitalization. And I just hope that when the businesses come, they can afford to pay a livable wage, and that people will be hired, and local people will still be able to be included in this community and build around what we already have, and that we can just make sure that it just continues for everybody to be included.
Thank you. Thank you. The next question goes to Brendan, and it's on climate change. Have you read any of the latest scientific models for near-term impacts on climate change? If so, how seriously do you think Vermont should be taking these reports? What should Vermont be doing to prepare for the impacts of migration, et cetera, caused by climate change?
Thank you. Actually, this is kind of funny, I guess, being a biology major in college, and it speaks to the wonders of our education system here in the United States. A lot of it was centered around climate change, and especially as an environmental biologist, I was there, that's what my thesis was in. I mean, the data speaks for itself. However, it needs to be controlled in a federal sense, not in a state sense. So I believe people who are here in Vermont are already very environmentally aware. We're one of the lowest in carbon emissions, and especially per capita, we're ranked the third best, actually, in carbon emissions per capita at just over 9 cubic tons per metric. So we're already environmentally aware, and that's already not considering a carbon tax or anything like that. So I think it's very important to be aware of climate change, but as sense of a state who is already very climate aware, and that we're already seeing declines in our carbon emissions, and even without a tax. I think it's a lot better for the federal government to kind of take this on, because there's more of an impact that can be seen in that sense rather than in the state. There is a greater hindrance in affordability and people who are living here based on something that controls the state, that you won't see the same benefit of our emissions going down. Being taken on as a federal legislator, that's where the most impact can be had based on the dollars that are spent. So that's where I kind of feel on the whole argument.
Okay. Well, I've viewed the latest research has come out, and I've seen the research goes back decades, 3-4 decades at least. And I think that we really don't even understand the monumental challenge that we have in front of us. The research that I've read indicates that assuming there's 7 billion people on the planet, we need to get our per capita annual carbon emissions down to 3 tons per person. Right now we're at 17.5. That's just over 80% decrease to get down to where we need to be at. And I agree with Brendan. Vermont's not going to solve this problem. We are 2/1000ths of 1% of the carbon emissions on this planet. We are not going to solve the problem. Clearly, I think the solution is to move dramatically towards electrification and to produce that electricity with sources that are not carbon emitting, or at least carbon neutral. And that's very perilous for Vermont, because our electric rates are some of the highest in the country. And right now, at least with carbon, we're on par for energy costs for the rest of the country. And if we have to move to electrification and be a terribly expensive energy state because of our electricity costs, that's going to do our economy. I've proposed that we do have sources where we can get electricity at carbon neutral or new carbon, hydro Quebec, biomass. Those are electric generation that we can compete in. Solar and wind are great, but we're the cloudy state in the nation, and we don't have wind swept prairies, and I don't think that we can be terribly competitive making our energy that way. Although we probably are going to have to make energy using solar and wind. But it's a monumental task, and we need to get started, and we need to do it in a way that our economy will survive.
Well, I don't know that I agree with this time, too. It's a monumental task. The Arctic ice cap is disappearing. Greenland glaciers are sliding off Greenland. Permafrost is melting. Oceans are warming and spawning 100-year storms every year. These are real facts. These are happening now with something like 1 degree Celsius rise in global temperatures since the 1800s. Just over the horizon, we have much more severe and even catastrophic effects, including social dislocation, migration, people moving out of low-lying areas, even more different resources. Locally, we still have effects here as well. Not only is the global economy going to shift because of this, but we're going to see effects here, like the ski industry being threatened, even the naval industry being threatened. We already see an increase in ticks for Lyme disease and moose ticks, and storm damage from Irene and other storms like that. So what do we gain by trying to address climate change now? Well, right now we spend $2 billion on fossil fuels, and most of that goes out of state. So if we invested some of that money in state in renewable generation and efficiency, which provide good jobs, and forestry and biomass, this would keep the money in our local economy.
We also can spend money on continuing to harden our infrastructure against the storms that are coming. We spent 2 years and $500,000 rebuilding that road. And that's the kind of thing we have to keep on doing. These are good jobs, and this will help our local economy.
Thank you. Jane?
I agree that we need to explore all ways to reduce fossil fuels. I think that climate is the most pressing struggle that we face. The climate must be considered in all of our policies, and we owe it to our children and grandchildren to lead on this issue. We continue to explore ways to and other resources to get different energy, renewable energy, and everybody has to help. I mean, it's not just, the whole community has to be involved in what we do here to change the climate, and that has to be a community effort as well.
Thank you. The next question following up on climate change is on renewable energy. Mr. Scott, sorry. The state is committed to relying on 90% of its power needs through renewable energy sources by the year 2050. Do you support this mission? Is it possible? If yes, what has to be done to support it? And if not, why not?
Well, yes. Yes. I think it's a doable goal. It's not going to be easy. My priority, though, is that I think it's something we can do through efficiency, through new technology. I think it's doable. But what I don't want to lose focus on is that in 2050, it does us no good to have 90% renewable energy if our economy's in shambles, because we've made everything so expensive to get there. So we need to keep the focus on that. And that goes along with affordability. Can we afford to live here? Does the economy work here, given what the costs of energy are, as well as the carbon output? We need to keep those both in mind. I think if we keep those both in mind, we can do both. I think we can have a renewable energy portfolio that also enhances the economy of the state and doesn't damage the economy of the state. But we're going to have to think differently. We're going to have to embrace technologies as they come about. I think we're moving into the battery storage age or the hydro storage age, depending on what assets that are available. I think that's key. I think that will make renewable energies more valuable. We won't have to, won't be generating and not having anywhere to use it, which seems to be the case right now in so many cases. But I think we can do it. Maybe we can do better than that. But we also need to be worried about our economy too, because we all have to react to a strong economy.
Thank you.
Well, again, I look at the transition to a low carbon economy as an economic opportunity. We can do a lot to bring use money that we're not spending on fossil fuels to bring good jobs here and increase the local economic activity and money to circulate in our local economy. Quebec started recently something called the Western Climate Initiative. It is a cap and trade system for limiting greenhouse gas emissions. And they also engaged other provinces and states. I think Ontario and California, and I believe Washington State is also probably joining. And Quebec started this about 10 years ago, I believe, started designing it. And their experience over the last 5 years has been a really enormous economic growth in their province. This is something I need to learn an awful lot more about, but I feel like that's a good example of how working with the reality of climate change, we can create an economic opportunity, an economic boost. So the question was, can we get to 90% renewables by 2050? Of course we can. We just have the will to do that. The problem isn't engineering, it isn't technical, it's political. It's do we have the will to do that? Hydro, jobs for people here. We just need to look at it.
Thank you.
I don't know what to add because I know more about it than I do, but I do think that we can have renewable energy, and I support that program that would have us moving towards renewable energy, 90% renewable energy by 2050. So I believe we should be working in that area and supporting those programs and finding a way to make them happen.
Thank you. Brandon? I didn't forget.
Yeah. Thank you. Appreciate it. Obviously, this is a huge topic, and I do think it is possible to get to 90% by 2050. But it, like Scott Beck said, it's really about balance, so making sure that we get there as well as our economy stays intact is very important, especially on allowing people to relocate here, be able to afford living here, and especially in their older ages when they have retirement funding that they need to look at. It's important to be able to maintain their living expense while they're living here as well. So being able to look at innovation and new technologies that are coming out every single day, it would be cost-benefit is very important. You need to really look at the effects of not only our carbon emission once it gets there to what we're trying to see in getting our carbon emission down, but also the effects that it has long-term by 2050 of what our economy looks like and who's remaining here and say who's relocating here. So having that balance is very important, and people that go to the state need to focus on that as well. So not just one side, but really looking at both. And a lot of it comes down to compromise as well.
Thank you. The next one goes to Scott Campbell. Where do you stand on the package of gun bills that was signed into law? Yep. That's it.
Well, I look at the gun issue as a public health issue, really. I sort of respect the rights of people to own guns. That is a well-established right, and I have absolutely no problem with that. I think that also there is a right that other people have to not be terrorized by guns. So I feel like we have to balance these rights. And the right to own whatever weapon you want is not an absolute right. There are limits. People are not allowed to own military weapons, bazookas or shoulder fire missiles or what have you. So it's a question of where the line is. And so that's what the debate is. From what I understand about the gun laws of the past, they are set. And so let's stay set. I also think that the people who are against those gun laws, well, what's your suggestion? How do we cope with the situation that we've got? We can't have people going and shooting up schools. We have kids getting terrorized just by having to go through active shooter training. I feel like this is really a crazy upside down world. We have to get a handle on this, and so let's do it.
Jane?
We have to have common sense gun laws. I think the way that the laws were passed were acceptable, and I believe that private citizens should be allowed to own firearms, and that we should protect citizens' rights without infringing on individual rights. I don't think more guns are the answer to what can happen to be safe. They scare me, but I think that if we can make common sense laws, then people should be allowed to own their own firearms.
Thank you. Brendan?
I think it's very important to defend the Constitution and everything that it incorporates. Looking toward the future, I can guarantee that I think we're at where we need to be, so I would not vote on any sort of restrictions on my constitutional right in the future if elected and go to the Capitol on your behalf. And not only defending the Constitution itself, but it's very ingrained in our culture here in Vermont. I know I've never personally gone out hunting, but many of my friends who I grew up with, that's what they grew up in. That's how they went out every single morning, bright and early, being able to bond with your father, being able to camp with your brother or sister or mom, whoever, and getting that excitement of bringing home meat for your family is very ingrained in what it means to be a Vermonter, and I think it's very important to protect that as well. And being able to really defend the Constitution too. So those two, in general, I believe it's very important to kind of harness that in our beliefs there, especially when we go to the Capitol and pass legislators and everything like that. So I can guarantee you that I think we're right where we need to be.
So, question for Senate Bill 55, which was signed into law by Governor Scott last, back in the spring. There was a lot of that bill that everybody agreed on in the Capitol. And the biggest piece was is that how do we keep dangerous people from having weapons? And that's what the bill started as, is that we have these people in our society that are potentially dangerous, and how do we keep weapons out of dangerous people's hands? And you had broad consensus, both parties, both chambers, the gun sense people, the pro-2A people, everybody was in agreement. I could have even gotten a little bit stronger on keeping weapons out of dangerous people's hands. And then we also had a piece where how do we prevent people from turning legal weapons into illegal weapons, and that was bump stocks, which turned out a fully legal semi-automatic weapon into a fully automatic weapon, which had been illegal in this country for nearly 100 years, and there was broad consensus on that. Where I think we missed the mark was, is we got tied up in restricting people's Second Amendment rights, and we did that needlessly. And the changes that we made, there's really no evidence to indicate that those changes would have prevented any of the horrific shootings that we've had in America. Magazine 10 rounds doesn't prevent those basic killings. They do them with less than 10. Background checks, all those people pass background checks. Where they would have received their weapons from people that had passed background checks. And so I thought in those two pieces, I thought we went too far in restricting Second Amendment rights. But I'm proud of the work we did in trying to keep dangerous weapons out of dangerous people's hands.
Thank you. Okay, the next question goes to Jane first. Marijuana. Now that we have legalized marijuana use, where do we go from here?
Well, I believe in the tax and regulation system of marijuana, and I would see that the revenue goes to treating opioid epidemic and substance use disorder treatment increased and develop a stronger answer to the opioid crisis with the revenue we can create from tax and regulation.
Okay, thank you.
I'm also in favor of taxing marijuana that is now legal, but I think there's also a lot of focus that we can do into the future now that it's legalized. One of them in particular, making sure that we have a rapid test on the roads so that the law enforcement can be able to really crack down on people who are using while driving vehicles and things like that. And there's not really a great one on the market, so that is one area that we really need to consider to make sure that the roads are safe. The second is, now that it's legal, there's a lot more opportunity for testing to be done, both on the benefits that have been seen in the past, but also the negatives that are potentially there. There's some sound evidence that there might be an effect on memory in long-term doses. Being able to get that knowledge out to the consumer so they can make a more educated decision on actually using it, I think is very important for our citizens here in Vermont.
We do need to how we can tax and regulate marijuana. We need to do it smartly. I hope we've learned as many lessons as we can from Colorado and other early adopter states. We can do it smartly. There's a big debate over is it going to be through state liquor stores or is it going to be free market, kind of like Colorado did. I know the governor doesn't want to pick marijuana in this state. We're going to keep it at the liquor store level, I believe. I think we need to be realistic about the revenues that it can produce. Once we lower our tax rate to be competitive with the states around us, we won't have the advantage of artificial market like Colorado has had recently, and look at the cost associated with everything that goes with it, enforcement, everything. I mean, there isn't going to be any money in the end for anybody. And that's okay. I mean, we should not be legalizing marijuana or legalizing the sale of marijuana for revenue. That's not the right reason to take those steps. There won't be any money in it. I see people say, we could eliminate the education property tax. It's not going to be happening. I love to eliminate the education property tax, but it's not going to be done with marijuana receipts.
Mr. Campbell.
Well, I too support taxing and regulating marijuana. And I also agree with Scott that I don't think there's going to be a lot of money left over after we implement that system. But it's clear that prohibition hasn't worked. And criminalizing people medicating themselves with whatever drugs, it has not worked either. So I would like to see us devote more attention to counseling and treatment, mental health treatment, than criminalizing marijuana or really any drug. I think the self-medication and drug addiction is a symptom of the larger ills in society, isolation and loneliness that are manifested in drugs and suicide social media and screen time and all kinds of sort of antisocial behaviors. So, because I'm saying this beyond tax and regulation, I would support a tax and regulation regime. Also, I don't know the details about it at this point. What do you think?
Thank you. So the next question goes to Brendan. It's a cost of living, and the question comes from a member of the audience. It's a personal situation, however you hear it commonly. So it's someone who's retired here a year and a half ago, and they're particularly worried about being able to afford to live here. Their Social Security is taxed, their property taxes have gone up, everything costs more, there's little industry. How do you address the difficulty of starting a business in Vermont, getting Vermont up to speed with high-speed internet? The concern is whether or not they can live here full-time versus part-time.
Yeah, I know this is a major issue in this area, and a lot of it goes down to making sure that our population stays up. So the dependency ratio is approaching 1-to-1, which is not going to help our tax here in Vermont. So making sure that we're getting a steady inflow of participants to relocate migrants. Last year, we were down to our net immigration was -1,900, which, I mean, it's a huge issue. Once you have more people paying taxes in this area of Vermont, you're able to really start looking at decreased cost of living. And I think that's very important. We don't want people who have lived there their whole lives and go into retirement and then have to relocate to somewhere new. It just doesn't make any sense. So making sure that really to focus on that area, and a lot of it comes down to being able to have places to have a career, which I said earlier. We already have a great education here. The environment is amazing. I personally love going skiing, doing everything you're able to do here in Vermont that you can't really find anywhere else. But a lot of it goes really down to affordability and being able to relocate here and actually have a career. And once we have the businesses that are being formed, very important, especially for the side of Vermont in the east. I feel like it's been very underrepresented in the past, and being able to voice the opinions of people who are here to retire and showing that it's, they want to stay here.
Thank you for the question. So I think demographics are really key here. You know, we're 620,000 people, we're stagnant, our population is getting older, or I think we're only being as older than we are. If we don't turn this around, look at 20 years, we're going to be a state of 500,000 people. And we may have the same bills as we have now today, which puts even more pressure on people. So we need to get ahead of this, address the affordability crisis in Vermont so that families can come here, stay here, remain here, get that base of workers that are really providing all the revenue for the economy. My first 2 years in the legislature under Governor Sean was the governor. We went in both years, state revenues in the general fund were increased about 2%. We increased spending 4.5%. Increased taxes, increased fees, did whatever we could, shifted some things over to the education fund to pay for that. I mean, that doesn't help senior citizens. Last 2 years, under Governor Scott, it's a different story. First year, 2017, we took the number of what the revenue is going to be for the state that year. We lived with it. It was a growth of about 2.2%. We lived with 2.2% growth. Made it happen. Second year, 2018, Governor Scott got some efficiencies in government. We grew the state, we grew the government spending at a lesser rate than the growth of the revenue. That allowed us to get an expansion of Social Security tax exemption to our senior citizens and disabled people. It allowed us to increase the earned income tax credit for our low-income Vermonters that are working. We have to do that for a few more years to correct the 8 years of just spend whatever you want, increase taxes and fees. We can't do that. We have to live within the growth of our government.
Thank you. Mr. Campbell.
Well, I'm going to agree with Brendan on this one. The solution to affordability is really bringing more people here to share the cost of the services that we all enjoy. And that we all need. And how are we going to bring more people here? I think we're going to bring more people here by, again, investing in the infrastructure and the amenities that we need in order to live here. So that's how I view dealing with the affordability issue and with older folks on fixed incomes having to deal with their taxes and property taxes and income taxes. If we spread the load, then each of us has less of a burden to carry.
I believe that having people come here and businesses growing here would help, and families being able to help and support each other. I think that the tax reform is good and helpful. I have the same concerns of how am I going to live here when I can't work 3 jobs. And so it's just something that we have to really pay attention to and really work towards finding out solutions and ways. I think there's not enough housing available that we can afford here for older people, and that we have to work for our services that we have already to continue to keep our elderly people here and safe. So all the suggestions that the others have, I agree with as well. And I just hope that we can make things better.
Thank you. One of the parts of that question had to do with high-speed internet. And it seems to be an issue. Do we have any answers for that? Do you want to give it just a short about? I was going to start with Brendan. If he had anything to say, we don't need to do a whole 2 minutes, but just if you have something that you think will work, can you get us internet?
Yeah. One of the ideas that from my master's program at the University of Notre Dame, there's a great it's already, most of the land railroads are on our state homes anyways, so you don't have to worry about acquiring the land that the infrastructure can be on. And, I mean, they're already cleared. Everything, all this up cost is basically gone or something like that. So I think that's a great avenue that we need to look into and see if it's a great benefit for here in Vermont. We have a lot of railroads all over the state, going back to our main industrial revolution back in the early 1900s, that we were able to build all these and have businesses here in Vermont and in St. Johnsbury. I saw some great pictures the other day on online about the businesses, especially how Railroad Street looked like when it was booming. And I think we can get back there.
It's so important, especially for our rural areas that don't have it right now. I talk to people in the education technology community a lot, and technology is evolving so quickly. They have not even been able to get their heads around exactly how many public investment dollars are going to be required. And public dollars are going to be required because we just don't have the population density to make it worthwhile for the communication companies to do it on their own. Their best guess is $1 billion. $1 billion of public money to get fiber optic throughout the entire state last mile. So where do you find $1 billion? Well, I think the feds are going to be part of the final solution. I think that we need to find efficiencies in government. Right now, a lot of people running around and say we're spending $70 million too much in corrections. Well, $70 million a year, that just about gets you there. And then there are other areas of the state that are experimenting with telecommunication districts, where they're seeing they can't do this on a district level. There's one in the middle of the state that's trying to get going. And maybe, maybe that's the answer. Maybe if people are going to agree to increase their taxes for something that they really value, maybe the way to do that is at the local level, the district level. There's a lot of towns in this area that have municipal tax rates that are a quarter of what St. Johnsbury is. And they're rural. Maybe they have capacity there to get involved and get the internet out to the rural communities. But it's very daunting, it's very technical, and I think we have to run in the private sector because if nothing else, Burlington proved that we don't want to get municipalities involved in telecommunications.
Thank you. Did you want to add to that, Mr.
Sure. This is supposed to be quick, right?
Yes.
And room for growth and for people to move up the ladder is a sustain themselves, helps to prevent all of that stuff. We have a lot of people in this community that are paycheck to paycheck on the border of financial ruin for a variety of different reasons. And some of them are working two or three jobs. And a lot of the stresses that are placed on them and placed on their families are a direct result of that scenario. We have to fight this from two ends. One is we have to make the state more affordable for these people to live, all people. And the other is we need to, as I spoke earlier, we need to take our people that and get them the skills and get them into the job training programs, which we already have in the state, and they're there. They're maybe not organized very well, and maybe not coordinated very well, but we need to fix that, and we need to get these people into careers or pregnancy stuff where there's more stability, there's more predictability, and the wages are better. And we just need to fight it from both ends. It's going to be a long, long slog. We have a lot of people that are trapped in some loops that are not healthy. The stress levels for many of them are very, very, very high, and it feeds into all of the problems that you just mentioned.
Mr. Campbell.
I think this addresses or feeds into what I think is one of the crucial issues that we're facing as a society, and I sort of mentioned it earlier, isolation and loneliness. We have an epidemic of loneliness and isolation. There was an excellent column recently by George Orwell paper about this very issue. And we have to deal with it. We have to address it. We have to talk about it. The rates of suicide have gotten so high in the state that the medical examiner no longer performs routine autopsies on suicides because there are too many. So just think about that. So I think that the question also got into incarceration, and I think that that is, we really need to rethink incarceration because we're kind of treating antisocial behavior that arises out of isolation and loneliness with more isolation. And we're not preparing those folks who are coming out of incarceration with the skills and the resources and mental attitude to become successful members of society. I don't know if any of you have seen Bess O'Brien's recent movie, Coming Home, which is excellent, and it's all about this issue. So these are things that I'm thinking about with the issues of incarceration, the issues of community stability.
I feel the foundation of helping communities is realizing the value and dignity of all the residents here. And in my work as a coastal volunteer for the Community Restorative Justice Center, I've experienced how support and accountability contributes to fostering better lives for our community members returning from incarceration. This is a model that I think that will serve many well and encourage us all to do better. I think that if we raise our level of expectations, we can have more members of our community that will participate, and I think we need to work with our community to keep things better and keep everybody from getting so depressed about all these issues that everybody's depressing me with tonight.
Thank you. Brandon.
So I don't think I'm crazy by saying that there's definitely a negative correlation between economic growth and happiness. if everything's going well in the economy, then obviously we have a lot more happier citizens. And a lot of it goes down to two factors. One of them is a future within the business, being able to know what you're striving for and what to get after. The second is responsibility within your work. And a lot of that is just driven down to careers. And I hate to keep being known and where they can actually strive to make those entrepreneurs know what to do and how to accomplish their goals. And I think we do need to do a little bit better job in that aspect here in Vermont.
Thank you. All right, the next question goes to Scott Campbell. What is your position on public funding for the arts?
Oh, I love public funding for the arts. Catalan Arts, which I'm on the board of, and I've been for the 2010, I believe, has proven to be one of the reasons why I got interested in being on the board, because I viewed it and the arts generally as a real economic driver, in especially in a community, a small community like this. And I think we are just so lucky to have an organization like Catalan Arts in a town of 7,500 people. And I think that because it's such an economic driver, it does deserve some support. Our particular situation with Catalan Arts was that we were due to get a significant chunk of federal support, which was back in the days of federal earmarks, that would help pay for the restoration of the building, the former Mason's building that we are now in. And that money fell through with the Great Recession of 2008. And the result of that was having a mortgage that we had to deal with, and we actually had to deal with it on a short-term basis for many years. Every year we had to refinance. Now at least it's a long-term mortgage, but we're still struggling with a situation where we have debt, and most arts organizations have endowments. So this is the kind of thing that I think the public ought to be supporting.
Jane?
I think public funding is important for the arts. I think all the kids in the community have benefited from what Catalan Arts is doing. I think that being able to have free concerts for everybody and our families to be able to enjoy all the things that they offer to us is really important, and I support the public funding.
Thank you. Okay.
We live in a very special environment here. That would mean we have Catalan Arts, we have the Athenaeum, we also have the Fairbanks Museum. So it's particularly great in this situation that we have so many avenues for the arts and just a quest for knowledge in general. And a lot of that goes back to just the nonprofits that are associated here in the town, and the involvement of the people who are here. I think it speaks wonders to all of you and everyone who's a part of this community that you're able to go to these venues, support, be able to go to the fundraising, and really help to keep these places here in St. Johnsbury. It's a super driving force to our economy, not only the people who are relocating here, because there's this opportunity to not only have their kids be involved in those sort of organizations, but also yourselves, and just the quest of knowledge in that sense. But as a nonprofit, I think it is super important to do a lot of funding and being able to drive those economic factors within the people who are here in the town to support them. And that goes to every sort of nonprofit that's associated here. And being able to get funding from the state is important, depending on what the situation is. So being able to get tax credits is particularly important, not only for the profit side, but the nonprofits who are associated here in the town. So I think we do a great job on that, and I definitely agree that we need to continue doing that sort of process.
For the modest amount of public dollars that are given to the arts, especially in this community, this is a really good bargain. I mean, this is like a good deal of all good deals. I mean, we have this building, Catamount Arts, state-of-the-art facility, the museum, the amplification that the St. Johnsbury Academy can offer. In the town of 7,200, there's no way we deserve these four institutions. But we have them, and they're fantastic, and we do it for very few public dollars, and the amount that they bring to our community is enormous. This, the Levitt series, the planetarium show that we had down at the church
this summer. In some ways, I know they can always do that, a certain amount of love for cat owners, they have an endowment instead of a mortgage. But it's almost impossible to imagine that these institutions could be any stronger or provide any more to this community than they do right now. We're really terribly lucky. I think if people not seeing you, what we have here, so I'm not trying to take it away from us. Unfortunately, they don't come over here very often, so I guess they have to go that way.
Just want to have them have apple tickets.
I didn't know you were on the board. We are at approaching the 8 o'clock hour, so we need to wrap up. There were some other questions. I'm sorry we couldn't get to them all. There is a question concerning tenant and landlord issues and problems, which I would hope that you will read this before you go, and hopefully maybe you have some thoughts on it. So to wrap up, we have a 1 minute closing statement, and what I would hope, one of the questions is, what will your priority be if elected, and how do you want to address that? How will you address it? So in your closing, if you could give us some idea of what a priority issue would be if elected. And we're starting with the reverse order. It's a 1 minute closing. So Jane, tell us first.
Thank you again for being here, and I really enjoyed talking about these issues and everything that I've heard tonight. I want to say my priority would be the opioid crisis, and I would like to try to do everything that we could possibly do to eliminate the opioid epidemic. And I want to say that we need to focus on growing as a community in unity. So we can't still do nothing and keep things the same. We have to plan to move forward in a way that is economically and environmentally and socially viable. People in St. Johnsbury need to feel supported in order to be better. In order to be better, we must do better and leave no one behind. Growing our economy and our community towards prosperity and health takes the whole village. None of us are here to hurt anybody else, and we're not evil, and we don't want to tax people to death, and we don't want to see anyone suffer from lack of jobs or health care, housing, child care, and safety. I want to do the best I can to be the voice of those who have the greatest needs and feel that they aren't being heard in my failure. And I have to say that we're not that company.
Thank you. Okay. Scott, Campbell.
I want to bring a long-term investment-oriented perspective to public policy. I believe that's the surest way to bring more prosperity, a more robust economy, and a stronger community. I think efficient and effective government can provide a foundation for private businesses and individuals to thrive. I do not think that requires more taxes, and I do not advocate more taxes. And I want decisions about public investment to be driven by outcomes. What will build the community? Because I think that is the final foundational issue that we're facing. How do we fight the isolation moments that has been engulfing our society and even our global community? I think the opposite of isolation is connection. And connection comes from engaging with the community, with each other, like we're doing tonight. Connection comes from doing things together with people who don't always think exactly as you do, but share something in the moment. The job to be done, oops, that's it. A concert to be enjoyed, a policy to be discussed. So I want my government to be focused on building a community, and that's why I hope to receive your support in the
Thank you.
Just like to thank the League of Women Voters, the Caledonian Record again for putting this on, and everybody in the audience for taking the evening out. My priorities when I go back to Pompeo will be to continue to be a voice for fiscal responsibility and making sure that our government isn't growing faster than the tax revenues that are coming into the city. And also to finish the work that I started in education. We've done governance reform, we've done special education reform, we've restructured the ed fund. The last piece is education finance reform. This town necessary only to support and reduce the rates of districts that are making different spending decisions than St. Johnsbury that just cannot continue and not continue to fight for that. And I appreciate your vote.
I want to take this opportunity to thank you all for joining us on this great evening on Tuesday, right before Halloween. I'm kind of disappointed I didn't see anybody wearing a costume to me.
Well, this concludes our candidates forum. I hope you feel more informed and ready to vote next Tuesday. Thanks for all the great questions, and thank the candidates for being here.